I want to speak this morning on the subject, blessed to be a blessing. It's a subject that I love to speak on because in my life, God has done miracles. Let me give you a little bit of my background. I was raised very poor my whole life. We lived in the projects part of the time. We lived in trailers that my dad got out of the junkyard a couple of times. One we called leprosy, and because we had to patch it up so many times to live in it. And then my dad started preaching, and he pastored all these really small churches. And most of the time, we lived in the back of the church. So we didn't even have parsonages in most of those churches. We lived in the back of the church, and they would convert some Sunday school rooms. And that's just kind of how I grew up. That was my whole life growing up. Most of that in Tennessee and in Georgia. And my brother, my sister, and I, we didn't know any other life. That's just how we lived. And to see what God has done in my life since then, it really amazes me. Never, never underestimate the power of a seed that you might sow in one person's life. I never forget the day that my professor at Lee, his name was Charles Beach, he took my paper and he ripped it up and he said, "You cannot write like this because there's books inside of you that have to be written." And I had no idea what he was talking about because he was prophesying over my life as a kid who was just barely making it through school, really not doing that well at the time. And he rips my paper up and prophesies over me and says, "You have to write better than that because there's books inside of you." I have no idea that I would write 46 books after that. And I just finished another one and I've got another one coming out next year. I have no idea any of that was even inside of me, but someone unlocked that power inside of me with just a word, really a spoken word. So when I see somebody talking about focusing on the future, I want to tell you, you cannot focus on anything that's going to have a stronger return in your life than to focus on your children and your youth. And I just applaud you, Heritage, for doing that, because that means not only is God going to bless you, but as God blesses them, the future of this church is just going to be amazing. One more time for focusing on the future. Put your hands together. I want to talk this morning on the subject of being blessed to be a blessing. So I want to start with this question. How many of you feel that you're blessed? Anybody in this room feel you're blessed? I really believe that I'm blessed, and you have to really believe that. So how many of you feel like America is a blessed nation? I mean, when you compare it to the other nations of the world, it's amazing that when some people from other nations talk about us, the Africans, when they talk about the Americans, they say not only do they have everyone in the room gets their, everyone in the house gets their own room, but they even have a room for their car, you know, and they can't believe that Americans would have a house, a room built on our house for a car, when a lot of them are trying to get out of the weather and all of them are under one roof. And so when you really look at America, we really are a blessed nation. So the question remains for me is, well, why did God bless our country so much? Well, I personally believe that God blessed us to be a blessing. Do you realize that Americans have financed much of the gospel efforts around the world? We have literally put the gospel on the globe in many parts of the world by financing missionaries and missionary efforts and evangelism around the world. This nation gives more to world evangelization than any other nation in the world, and we've been doing that for a century now, that we've been financing the gospel around the world. I believe that God raised us up so that we could bless the world. I believe that God didn't just give us a great country to live in so that we could have nicer homes and we could drive nicer cars and wear better clothing. I don't think that's why God gave that to us. I believe that there's responsibility with blessings, and I personally believe that God blessed this country because now we've turned around and blessed the world because God has blessed us. So I believe that if you have a blessed life, that God has chosen you for a particular reason. And sometimes he does that because he sees the spirit of generosity that's in you, and he knows that if he blesses you, then he can bless someone else. I believe that if God can get it through you, he can get it to you. How many of you believe that? If he can get it through you, he can get it to you. But some people want to, they see their gift differently. They just see it as something that God's given me. I see myself as conduit. God, whatever you give me, whenever you need it, wherever you want it, wherever you send me, that's what I want to give to you. So understand that there is a responsibility for a blessing, not only for our country, but also for my household. So I want to go back into an old story of the Bible and talk for a few moments about Abraham. Now, you got to remember the story of Abraham as we know him as Father Abraham. This is long before then. Abraham was raised in the home of an idol maker. So he was not a God-fearing man, but in the course of this, his father had a vision or a dream that he wanted to move his family. So it started with Abraham's father. He wanted to move his family to Canaan, but he never got that far. So Terah wanted to move his family to Canaan, but he got as far as what would be Iraq today. He got as far as Ur of the Chaldeans. And there in that country, they started heading to Canaan, and then they made it to what would be modern-day Turkey. They made it as far as a place called Haran in their day. His father was old by this time, and he never could finish the journey. So God goes to Abraham, and he says, I know that your father wanted to move your land, your family to Canaan, but if you will trust me and follow me, I will not only let you move to Canaan and help you move there, I will give you the land of Canaan. Now, I don't know how that conversation went down. I don't know if that was a voice, a still small voice, handwriting on the wall. The Bible doesn't say how God said it, but Abraham understood it, that even though he was 955 miles from where he started, he believed that God, a God he never served as a child, a God he never served in his father's home, he believed that God spoke to him and said, I'm choosing you because I see something in your heart that I can use. And if you will walk out this by faith, this promise that I'm giving you, I will make a great nation come from you. Here's a man that had no children. Here's a man that had no wealth at this time. He was living in Iraq. So he started out there. And so he starts on this crazy journey. Let's just be honest, folks. It was a pretty crazy journey. If God showed up in Oak Ridge and said, Coach Phil, if you will just sell everything you have, get your backpack, and start walking, everywhere you walk, I will give it to your children. And then you would have to leave your job, you would have to leave your home, and you'd have to talk your wife into going with you. Now, that's another side of the story. So you would have to get her on board as well. So he has to get Sarah to go with him, and then this guy leaves everything. He can't own a home. He can't own land. These are prerequisites. God says you can't own any of it. All you're going to do is spend the rest of your life hiking. And if you spend the rest of your life hiking, now how many of you know that took a lot of faith? That took a lot of faith. Okay, God, I'm going to spend the rest of my life hiking, and I just told my wife we could never own a house. I just told my wife that we can never own property, that we're going to be nomads, and we're going to live in tents, and we're going to hike the rest of our life. And God said, if you'll do that, I'm going to use you as a miracle to the world. I'm going to show the world that I can not only raise up a nation, I can raise up a Messiah from somebody who can just walk out a walk of faith and not look back and trust God for ridiculous things and impossible things and supernatural things. And so the Bible says that Abraham believed God, and that's what changed everything. He believed it. Now, he didn't have to believe it, but Abraham believed God. And even when you read about Abraham in the book of Hebrews and the great hall of faith, you know, he says that Abraham was counted worthy because of one thing. He believed God. When God said it, he said, okay, God, this is ridiculous. Nobody's ever done this before. You're going to give my children this land. I don't even have kids. And you're going to give my children this land if I will hike the rest of my life with my wife and never own property. Really? And God said, yeah, that's it. That's the deal. Okay, I'll do it. This is crazy, but I'll do it. It makes no sense, but I'm going to do it anyway. So this man, Abraham, starts on a journey that began to change everything. The first thing God said is, if you'll do this crazy thing, how many of you know God asks us to do crazy things sometimes? Anybody besides me, God ever asked you to do something just didn't make sense to anybody else? And let's be honest, it didn't make sense to you either when God asked you to do it. I can tell you, God's asked me to do so many things in my life that it's like, really? This is really what you want? Because everyone's going to think I've lost my mind if I do it. But if it's really what you want, I'm going to trust you that your plan is going to prevail. And sometimes even in the interval of all of that, it's like, okay, between point A and point B, everybody's saying, what have you done? What's going on with you? And all you can say is, well, I'm trusting God. I'm doing something God told me to do that didn't really make sense to me. That's exactly where he's at. But listen to what God said. The first thing God said is, I will bless you so much that you're going to have something to give away. I will bless you and you are going to be a blessing to everybody else. He says, God, did you see us? It's me and Sarah and two goats and one sheep. It's us. We have no kids. I've got my nephew that's tagging along with us because he's going to cut the wood. You know, I mean, this is all it is, Lord. We don't have anything. God said, it doesn't matter. A little is much when God is in it. And if you will walk out a walk of faith that even sounds absolutely ridiculous and makes sense to nobody but you, God said, I will do something so crazy that in the end, nobody can get the credit but God. The king can't take the credit and your family can't take the credit and you can't even take the credit, because by the time I get through, everybody, even your enemies, will say, that had to be God. There is just no other explanation. That had to be God that pulled that off that way. So Abraham starts on this ridiculous journey. And here's what God says to him in Genesis chapter 12. Now the Lord said to Abram, get out of your country and from your family and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. Okay, we've covered that part. Here's verse 2. And I will make you a great nation. I will bless you and make your name great, and you shall be a blessing. So here's the first promise. If you do this, I will bless you to be a blessing. Everybody else is going to be blessed. They are going to live in the overflow of my favor on your life. As a matter of fact, I'm going to bless you so much that just the people who know you're going to be blessed when they see what I'm doing. You're going to leave behind more than you took. I mean, you're going to come and go, and just the residue of your presence is going to leave behind a blessing everywhere you go. And when you look at Abraham's life, it happened that exact way. Everywhere he went, it was a crazy, ridiculous, extreme kind of favor that God put on him. He could go to a strange country, go dwell in the king's house. The king took his wife, okay? So the king takes his wife. Abraham goes and tells him that that's really not my, she's my sister, because he thinks he's going to kill him. God goes to the king and says, listen, if you take that man's wife, he's a prophet, then I'll bring judgment on your house. And not only does the king say, get out of here, the king blesses him. The king has stolen his wife, and God takes what was meant for evil and turns it for good. Now the king says, okay, Abraham, not only do I want you to leave, I want you to take a lot of money with you when you leave. How many of you know that doesn't make sense? Anybody besides me said that doesn't compute? That's not 2 + 2 = 4. That doesn't make sense. But when you are walking in a walk of faith, God begins to bless you just so. Sometimes it's not even about you. Sometimes the blessing has nothing to do with you. It's just that God is using you as conduit to get a blessing into somebody else's life. And God says to Abraham, he said, I'm going to make your name great, and I'm going to bless you so much that you can be a blessing. He said, not only that, I'm going to bless those who bless you, and I'm going to curse those who curse you. I mean, that's a pretty good promise right there. I mean, sometimes you have to turn your enemies over to the Lord. Instead of you going after them, you have to believe that God said, vengeance is mine, I will repay. Even when someone tries to hurt you, even when they lie on you, even when they come against you, even when they speak evil against you, you have to say, okay, God, you said not only am I blessed, you said you're going to bless those who bless me, you're going to curse those who curse me. I'm going to trust you. I don't care who's saying what and who's doing what and who's pointing their finger. I am blessed, and you don't have to ask anybody's permission to bless me. God doesn't even have to ask your boss if he wants to give you a raise. God doesn't even have to ask a realtor if he wants to give you a house. God doesn't have to ask the mayor if he wants to give you favor in the city. God can bless you regardless of who doesn't want you to get blessed, who doesn't think you should have got blessed, who thought that should have been their blessing instead of your blessing. I'm here to tell you, God can bless you in the face of adversity. God can bless you in the face of ridiculous things that are coming against you that doesn't even make sense. God can bless you just because he wants to bless you. He doesn't need anybody's permission to bless you. Can you put your hands together and give the Lord praise in his house? Hallelujah. God says, I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you, and in all the families of the earth shall be blessed because of you. I'm going to bless the other families because I'm blessing you with this ridiculous miracle. Now, you may stop and think, well, that's a great promise to Abraham, right? And that's a great Bible story. But there's something you need to know about that Bible story. When you get over into the New Testament, and you start reading the writings of the Apostle Paul. I want to read this slowly because it's got to sink in. Because if you've never believed this about yourself, you need to start believing it today. Okay? So listen to what happens in Galatians 3. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having been made a curse for us. For it is written, curses everyone who hangs on a tree. Now, how many of you know that Jesus died on the cross, right? How many of you believe that part? So just track with me for a minute. Okay, that's only about, well, are we in a church this morning? That was only about 20%. How many of you believe Jesus died on the cross? Okay, I'll see the rest of you in the altar later, but we're off to a good start, okay? So you believe Jesus died on the cross. How many of you believe that when he died on the cross, that he removed your sin? How many believe that? That he removed your sin when he died on the cross? How many believe that when he died on the cross and he was resurrected, that he also paid a price for you to be healed? How many believe that? That by his stripes you're healed? I believe that. How many also believe that he was wounded for your transgressions? He was bruised for your iniquity. The chastisement of your peace was on him, which means you are entitled to peace. You are entitled to live without shame and guilt and remorse. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. That the cross did every bit of that for us. The cross did all of that for us, right? But there's something else that the cross did for us. It also became a bridge. Everybody say bridge. It became a bridge. What kind of bridge? He redeemed us from the curse of the law that the blessing of Abraham, verse 14, that the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles in Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. Wait a minute. Did you just say that Jesus died on the cross so that I could receive the blessing of Abraham because I'm not Jewish? Does that mean that because I am of Christ? Well, notice what the rest of that verse says. Now to Abraham and his seed. Capital S, to Abraham and his seed were the promises made. He does not say, and to seeds as of many, but one, and to your seed who is Christ. Did you get that? He said the promise was not given to Abraham and his seeds, his children. The promise was given to Abraham and his seed, which was the Christ. God was not only raising up a nation through Abraham, he was raising up the Messiah through Abraham. And he said the same promise that God gave to Abraham and his children, that if you believe in Jesus Christ, then God says, I will bless you to be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you because you are in Christ. Now the promise of Abraham is also the promise to you and your house. I don't know about you, but that's pretty exciting to me. I mean, it's just like God walked in your living room now and said, if you'll trust me and if you'll walk by faith, I'll bless those who bless you. I'll bless you so much the nations of the earth will be blessed through you. I'll bless you so much families in your neighborhood will be blessed by you. I'll bless you so much that just the overflow of your life will cause blessing in the lives of other people around you. If this is true, why don't more people believe it? If this is true, why aren't more people walking that promise out? Because I know how promise works. You have to speak it. You have to claim it. It's like winning the lottery and never turning in your ticket, right? You don't get any money that way, right? Not that I'm, you know, maybe that's a bad illustration, but nevertheless, you got it. It's like, I won, but I'm just going to sit here and look at this torn up ticket, and I'm never going to cash it in. God said, you won. All you have to do is redeem it. And when you redeem it, there is a promise. If you are in the seed of Jesus Christ, there is a promise for you and your house that God wants to bless you in an incredible way. Now, before Abraham could get the blessing, he had to pass a test. So God comes to him and says, do you really believe that I'm going to bless you? And he says, yeah, God, you said you bless me. He said, then you and Lot have grown now. Now that this king has blessed you, you got more goods than you can deal with. You got to separate because you don't want any division in your family. So I want you to decide. I want you to decide what you're going to give to Lot and what you're going to take for yourself. And then he said, Lot, now you choose. So you know the story. If you don't, here's how the story goes. Lot chooses the best part and sends Abraham into the desert. So he chooses the plains of Jordan, the grassy fields and the rivers. And he says, okay, if I get a choice, this is what I want. And so that's the way he went. And Abraham says, okay, God, no, this really doesn't make sense again. Here I am. Man, Sarah's asking me questions I can't answer. So are you going to bless us here? And this is what God said. If you can lift up your eyes from where you are, look to the north, the south, the east, and the west, he said, don't look for your blessing to come from one place. Look for it to come everywhere. There are miracles going by you every single day that you are missing. There are miracles. There are opportunities going by you every single day. You're one phone call from a miracle. You're one day getting up from a miracle. You're one meeting from a miracle. God said, don't just look for one source to become your miracle. Look unto the hills from where your help comes from is what David said. God said, I'm everywhere, and I want to bless you wherever you are. Can you see it from where you're at? And he said, yeah, okay, I see it. It's Jericho, but I'll take it. It's amazing that when the children of Israel came into Canaan, the first city they conquered was the city of Jericho. They had the great wall around it. And this is what God said. Pastor talked about the tithe earlier this morning. God said, okay, if you take anything from Jericho, you lose the rest of it. Jericho's the tithe. Don't even take a coin. See, tithing is not about giving. Tithing is about not taking. It's not even about giving. It's just about, am I going to keep what's not mine? Am I going to keep what's God? So it's not even about me giving God anything. It's really about God saying, okay, Jericho's the tithe that you're going to take it and give it. If you take it, then you can have it. You can have Jericho, but you can't have the rest. But if you leave everything here, and that's where the sin of Achan happened, he said, well, this little bag of gold ain't going to mess with anybody, and they lost the next battle. Because God said, wait a minute, I told you not to take it because that was mine. And so there's always a test. And the test sometimes is about not taking something that God asked for. It's not really about giving anything because God never asked you for anything that he doesn't have a plan to bless you with. So sometimes you got to pass the giving test. I had a guy in my church in St. Louis. His name was Mike. And Mike taught me one of the greatest lessons that I've ever learned in my life. Mike came to me one day. He was talking about Malachi 3. And he said, Pastor, the Lord's been convicting my wife and I. Her name was Mary. He said, the Lord's been convicting my wife and I and telling us that he wants to bless our storehouse, but we don't have a storehouse. And he said, this is the scripture he's given me. He said, he's going to rebuke the devourer for our sake. And I knew what Mike meant. Mike's son had become an alcoholic, and his daughter had just gone through a horrible divorce, and his lives were in a mess. And he said, the Lord said that there's a devourer in our house, and that God will rebuke that devourer if I will just trust him and walk by faith. I said, well, what does he want you to do, Mike? He said, well, the Lord told me to start a storehouse and to give it to him. And he said, I think I have a spiritual gift of giving. I said, well, that sounds good to me. Every pastor's ready for that one, right? So I thought, hallelujah. Thank God for more people with the gift of giving. I didn't pay much attention to it, to be honest with you. And I said, well, Mike, what's the goal? He said, well, I would like in my lifetime to give $10,000 to the church. He said, that's what I want to do. And I said, well, praise God, I'd like to do that too. I'd never done that in my lifetime either. And so Mike was an airplane mechanic. He worked for a small airport outside of St. Louis. It wasn't even the main airport. And so Mike comes to me in about 3 months. He and his wife, they sit in my office, said, Pastor, we want to give the church a blessing. I said, okay, that's great. He handed me a $10,000 check. And I said, Mike, I don't get it. I know you, Mike. I know your job. I know what your wife does. And you don't have $10,000. He said, well, we do now. I said, what do you mean you have now? He said, God told us to start a storehouse. So we started a bank account we called our storehouse. And I told the Lord, every bonus you give me, I'm not going to take it. I'm going to put it in the storehouse and give it to you. Just every bonus. We're going to live on everything. I'm just not going to take the extra. He said, and you wouldn't believe it. He said, on that, Pastor, I got a pay raise now. I'm not only a mechanic. I'm now the head mechanic over the other mechanics. And I said, well, man, that's great. And he handed me this $10,000 check. I said, well, what now? Because he had accomplished his goal, and Mike said, well, I want to give more. I said, well, praise God. You know, I'm the pastor, and this is great. So, and I'm telling you, the whole time God's teaching me a lesson, and I don't even know I'm learning it. I don't even know that God's using him to teach me this lesson. I saw this young mechanic's faith just go crazy. Well, if God can do that, he can do this. Yeah, Mike, look to the north, the south, the east, and the west. He's quoting scriptures every time I see him. He's trusting God for miracles. He comes back about 6 months later. By that time, honestly, I'd kind of forgotten about it. He comes back 6 months later, and he says, we want to have a meeting with you, Pastor. And they came. I honestly didn't think it would be anything else. I didn't know why they wanted to meet. I met with them, and Mike and his wife hands me an envelope. And they said, we want you to open it. And I said, well, what is it? He said, it's our storehouse money. Okay, but praise God, Mike. Opened it up, a $50,000 check. I said, Mike, wait a minute. Last year, you were struggling to pay your tithes. You've already given now $60,000 in a year. How's this? What's happening? Have you invested in something? He said, no, I'm telling you, it's just storehouse principle. I'm giving God. I've told God, if you bless me, I'll give you the overflow for ever how long you require of me. Here's the way the story goes, and I'll just move along because this story goes on for 5 years, okay? As Mike continues to grow, not only does he become the head of the maintenance department, he advances so much that they make him a part owner in the airport. Not only that, they end up selling the airport, and Mike comes to me the last time. Now, he has given me a $10,000 check, a $50,000 check, a $100,000 check, and now I'm thinking it's done. So he's already given me that much in about 3 years period of time. And so Mike comes to me one day and he says, Pastor, he said, I hate to tell you, but Mary and I are going to have to leave the church. I said, oh my goodness, not Mike. God, anybody but Mike, I'll trade you 10 more for Mike, but not Mike. And I said, why are you leaving? He said, you won't believe this, but he said, the airport just sold. And he said, I was made a part owner. He said, and I have become a multimillionaire. And I said, well, why would you leave the church now, Mike? And he said, because God has told me that he didn't just give me this so I could sit on it. He said, God wants me to travel around the country in one of these and to bless churches everywhere I go. He said, but before I do, Mary and I want to give you our last storehouse check for the church before we leave. And he gave me a $500,000 check for the church. Now, I've heard of ridiculous stories like that, but that's the first time anything like that had ever happened. And it began to stretch my faith in crazy ways because this is not somebody from another city that I don't know the real. I know these people. Not only that, his son is now a youth pastor, and his daughter's life has been restored, and she's also doing deaf ministry in a church. I'm telling you, God not only blessed him, God restored his family, God rebuked the devourer, God did every single thing that Mike and Mary were believing that God was going to do. And here's been the funnest thing, one of the most fun things that's ever happened to me as a pastor, is I will get a phone call on a Monday morning. And this guy, the first time it happened was in Cuba, Missouri. I remember. Small little church in Cuba, Missouri. This pastor calls me because I knew this pastor. He said, Brian, he said, do you know a guy named Mike? I said, yeah, I know Mike. He said, he just gave $50,000 to our church yesterday. I said, yeah, that sounds like Mike. Oh, God, that sounds like Mike, you know. And I had to start getting happy about it because it wasn't very long. I would get a call from California from some little struggling pastor said, Brian, do you know a guy named Mike? Oh, yeah, I know Mike. He just pulled up to our church. And we came out to church on a Sunday morning. This big RV is in the parking lot. And he just paid our church out of debt this morning. I said, yeah, that sounds like Mike. And I'm telling you, that story has been going on now for 10 years. Mike and Mary are still on the road. I hope they go, they come through Oak Ridge at some point in time, because this is, these are, not only that, I got a birthday card from them last week with a $25 check in there. So, you know, I'm not greedy and God's testing me, but I got a $25 check and a birthday. They never forget anybody in our family's birthday or anniversary. And I called them when I got, I said, where are you guys at? Well, this week we're in Oklahoma. I know somebody in Oklahoma is about to get blessed this morning. I have no idea where they're going to end up, but this couple literally travels the country in one of those big RVs, and all they do, wouldn't you like to have a job like that? All they do is bless churches everywhere they go. They just go in, worship, and they're some of the best worshipers. If you ever saw them, you wouldn't think they were millionaires. They're jumping all over the place. I mean, if God did that for me, I'd probably be worshiping like that too. I mean, they're jumping all over the place. They're now hitting retirement age. They're probably, you know, early 60s by now. And it's amazing what God has done. And they've spent a decade of their life since about 50 years of age. They spent a decade of their life in early retirement just giving money away in the kingdom of God. A ridiculous, pressed down, shaken together, running over, supernatural kind of thing that you don't hear about. But you know why they did it? Because God said, if you'll just obey me, I will bless you. I don't want you to obey another person. I don't want you to obey just the preacher. I don't want you to just, I've heard people say so many times, if the man of God says this, you know, no. If the man of God says something and God confirms it in my spirit with his word, then I'm going to go with it. I never give money because somebody told me to give money, but I always give money when God tells me to give money. There's a big difference because God knows what is in store for that kind of blessing. Because here's the second thing that God did. Now, God didn't have to do this. God just told Abraham, I'm going to bless you. The first promise and the second promise is not even close together in the Bible. The first one's in chapter 12 of Genesis. This is now, we're way over in chapter 22. Abraham's walking out the favor. He's walking rich. He's wealthy. He still doesn't have any children, but he's walking out his life wealthy now, and God's blessing everywhere he goes. Cities are being established. People are blessed. Everywhere he goes, the overflow of his life, he's just blessing everybody. God says one day, I want you to bring me an offering. What kind of offering can I bring you? Because now he's a wealthy man. I mean, he's blessed kings. He's blessed a lot of people. I said, no, not that kind of offering. This is different. I want you to bring me five animals, and I want you to cut them in half, and I want you to lay them on the ground. I want to walk out a blood covenant with you. Now, what a blood covenant means is that two people walk through a blood covenant, and the idea behind it is if either one of us break this contract, what's been done to these animals will be done to you. So you better not walk out of blood covenant unless you're real serious about it. So he says, I want you to cut them in half. So he takes the ram, he takes the goat, all the things that God tells him, the five animals, the ram, and Abraham walks through it. His feet are muddy, or his feet are bloody, and he's waiting on God. And then nothing happens. It's like the test again. Okay, God, you told me to do this. Where's the magic? Where's the, you know, the bells and whistles? God says, wait. Birds show up. He has to fight off the birds. Nightfall comes. And after Abraham stood the test of faith and wouldn't even allow himself to go to sleep because he was watching over a covenant, God shows up like a burning furnace and a torch. That had to be a scene. I hope they recorded that because I'd like to see that movie when I get to heaven. And I'm sure they did. But I'd like to see that one day. God shows up like a burning furnace and a torch. And he walks right through the middle of that. He says, okay, what now? And God turned around and said, Blessings I will bless you. Multiplying I will multiply your descendants. Now for the first time, Abraham now has a promise for his children. It's no longer just about him. He says, I'm going to multiply your descendants as the stars of the heaven and the sands which are on the seashore, and your descendants shall possess the gates of their enemies. Do you realize what that means? That no enemy will ever come against your children that they can't defeat. That's a good promise. Abraham says, I don't even have kids yet. Yeah, but when you get them, they're going to need this promise because they're going to get in a battle. But I promise you, from this day in this blood covenant, I'm giving you this promise that your children are going to be blessed and that no enemy will ever come against your child that your child cannot defeat. They will possess the gates of their enemies. My wife and I were so challenged by Mike and Mary, and that God began to deal with us about breaking a cycle off our life. I told you a little bit about my childhood. I was raised in poverty, so was my wife. And we met at Lee, neither one of us on scholarship. We were there getting by the skin of our teeth, both working full-time jobs to pay our way through Lee. My parents have never set foot on Lee University campus. They were poor, and they just, that wasn't their thing. They couldn't afford the education. I think it was guilt. They felt guilty that they couldn't help, and so they never even came to the campus once. I went to the campus. I'll never forget showing up. I was from Tennessee. I was living over in Cosby, Tennessee at the time, where Dad was pastoring a small church in the country. And I showed up in a cowboy hat and cowboy boots. Believe it or not, that's how I went to Lee. And I didn't know. And I said, well, I got to sign up for the work study program. And so I did that. I got a part-time job. I even planted a church in Knoxville. And I was going up there, the Lovell Heights Church that's there now. I planted that church when I was a college student. And so I was doing everything I could do just to pay for my education. And my wife did the same thing. She was working at Kmart there in Cleveland. And we were just doing anything we could do because we have no funding for our education. I had a $1,000 gift that was given to me by a tomato farmer. They said, we don't have any kids, and so take this as far as it will go in your education. That was my only scholarship that I ever got. So we're out there working it out. And so the bottom line is we had school debt up to our eyeballs for years to come. And so we're thinking, okay, we don't want our kids, you know, raised this way. Now, we were blessed, and God had blessed us. Our church was growing, but we just had a lot of debt in our life, to be honest with you. And I said, Lord, I really want to get out of debt. I'm tired of living like this from hand to mouth, working all these jobs. And even though I was pastoring, I was still doing everything I could do just to put it all on the debt. You know how it is. You're chunking down that debt load. And my wife and I wanted to buy another house. I almost pulled a picture of it to show you. And so we were going to buy a house, and we'd saved up $10,000 to put it on this new house. And the Lord spoke to me. There was an evangelist that came through our church, and he wasn't asking for money. He just preached a message that just convicted my soul. And the Lord spoke to me and said, there's a struggling Christian school down the street that's about to close. I want you to take that $10,000 and give it to them. Now, he wasn't asking me to give the church's money. He was asking me to give the only $10,000 I had that was going toward our house. And I thought, you got to talk to Sarah this time. My wife's name is Faith, but you know the story I'm in. You got to tell Sarah this time because we're going to be in a tent for a long time now. And so I was so dreading telling my wife, and I knew the Lord had spoken to me. And the Lord, by the way, I know she has it. Got to come with me. So there she is. There's my redhead. And so I was going to talk to Faith that next morning, and she came to me in tears, and she said, Brian, she said, I've been dreading telling you this, but I really felt like during that sermon yesterday, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and told me that we need to give our savings money away. I said, where? She said, he didn't say where, but he said, you would know where. I said, are you kidding me, Faith? I said, I was getting ready to tell you this morning. Did he tell you to give all of it away? He did. I said, yeah, he told me the same thing. Are you really in agreement to do this? And I said, yeah. I said, we get our house up for sale. We might not get to buy the house. I don't care. I want God's blessing. I want our kids to be blessed. If we have to stay in this house the rest of our life, I'm okay with that. That's what she told me. I said, okay. If it's not jeopardizing the sale of our house, then we're going to go ahead and go through it. I'm telling you, I got so pumped. My faith, I can't tell you what it did to me. My faith rose up in me so much that I wrote the check out as soon as we finished the conversation. And I took it immediately over there. And I said, I want this to go in the bank today. Because I was afraid I would change my mind. Or if you're married to a redhead, you don't want them changing their mind. I'm just going to leave it there. Leave it on the altar. But you don't want them changing their mind. That's all I'm going to say. And so I thought, we did it. And I come home and I said, okay, honey, we did it. We have never done anything like that in our whole life. I mean, that was crazy for us. We have never done it. We saw Mike and Mary, but that was the only story we knew like that. We didn't know anybody else had ever even seen anything like that happen. And so we put our house on the market. It was Labor Day weekend. We went away so they could show the house, and they had an open house showing. And our realtor, who was a girl there in the church, a young girl, she called and she said, Pastor B, we got a problem at your house. I said, oh, my goodness, already? She said, we've had a great showing, but she said, we have 8 contracts on your house. And I haven't written a contract yet. I don't even know how to write one. And I was going to ask my mother, who's also a realtor, I don't know what to do with 8. And I said, well, don't ask me. Call your mom. She's the one that knows real estate, not me. And so her mom says, well, tell them, you know, each of them that you got contracts. There was these 3 families that got in a bidding war. And we had our house price nice, and we wanted to sell. But God is my witness. What I'm telling you is the honest to God truth. And you can look it up on the internet, because you can see what the house sold for when we sold it. When that house, they got in a bidding war. And they called us back and they said, you got to come back. This one couple is irate. They want to sign the contract today. They've put up the most money. She said, you were hoping to get a $30,000 profit out of your house. But if you come home today, and we weren't that far out of town, and sign this, you'll make a $135,000 profit. Now listen, I was hoping to make $30,000 profit. And I kid you not, God gave it back to us, pressed down, shaken together, running over. And can I tell you something? Here's the difference. Nobody told us to do that. If a person told me to do it, it would not have worked. But I knew that God said, this is a seed I've put in your hand. I am testing you to see if you believe that I'm a God of miracles, that I can do pressed down, shaken together, running over kind of things in your life. And we did that. We paid off our school bills. We bought the next house, and we went into that. And guess what? The good news is God kept blessing in other ways. And I don't know how many people can say this, but we're debt-free today. And you're talking about a couple of kids that came from the country that was absolutely broke, and I can tell you that we are debt free today to the glory of God. And I only say that for His glory. But you know what? Because of that, we support just me and Faith. We by ourselves, we're supporting over 15 missionaries right now. Just by ourselves, we're putting a Haitian student through medical school right now to go back to Haiti and start a medical practice right now. Because when you step out on faith, God begins to do things in your life that absolutely blow you away. It's not about you. It's not about being chosen. God says, if I can get it through you, I can get it to you. But I'm looking for a generous heart and a generous hand. Can you give God praise for all these incredible things He's done? I'm going to have to hurry and finish here. I'm about out of time, but I think I am out of time, so I'll make this quick. 2 Corinthians says, by this I say, who sows sparingly shall reap sparingly. Who sows bountifully shall reap bountifully. And God is able to make all grace abound toward you. And you see, that's God giving something to me, that you always have an all sufficiency in all things. Wait a minute. Do you see verse 8? God's going to make sure that I have everything so that I'm lacking nothing so that I can do more for Him. Do you see that? That's Mike and Mary right there. All my grace is going to abound toward you, that you'll have sufficiency, that you may have an abundance for every good work. Brian and Faith, I'm not just blessing you because I picked you to be debt-free from poverty. I'm picking you because your hand is open to me. If I tell you to do something, you'll do it. If I tell you to step out on faith and send a Haitian student to medical school, you'll do it. If I tell you to pay some kid's college, you'll do it. I'm not just choosing you because you're special or you have a, you know, I'm telling you, I was a poor kid from the country, barely making it through school. I'm one of those who should have never earned a doctorate, but I have two of them. It's ridiculous. It's ridiculous. The story of my life and the story of my wife's life, she was adopted. Her adoptive parents broke up and divorced when she was 8. She was readopted out a second time. This girl should have lost her mind from some of the stuff she's been through. And she is a wonderful wife and mother. She's an incredible musician and singer because of God's grace. You cannot, when you begin to walk in God's favor and blessings, I'm telling you, and we are believing already that our children will never meet an enemy that they cannot conquer because of the blessing of God in our life. You see, anybody knows how many seeds there are in an apple, but only God knows how many apples there are in a seed. And I don't know what God's going to do if I release a seed. I don't know. I can count and say, okay, this is what I have, God. Why do you want it? And God says, no, I want something. I kind of feel like David. Nothing broke for me as long as I was giving to God that which really cost me nothing. Because for years and years, we were writing $1,000 checks. For years and years, we did that. Because we could. Then God asked us to do something we couldn't do. And we did it. And it changed everything. David was trying to stop a curse from another generation. He stood in front of the death angel and offered up a gift of sacrifice to the Lord. And Ornan said, no, listen, you're saving my kids too. I'll give you this threshing floor. And David said, wait a minute. I'm not going to give to God that which costs me nothing. If this is a true gift to God, I got to feel it. If I don't feel it, I really didn't do anything. I just appeased it. I tipped the Lord. If I didn't feel it, I really haven't made a step of faith yet. Maybe I've participated, but if I don't feel this, David said, no, I'm paying you full price for the threshing floor because I'm saving my kids. I can tell you that when God began to bless our life, everything changed. I want to end with one story. I'm going to ask the musicians to come back. I changed the name of this couple because they don't want their name mentioned, but Mike and Mary is the real name, but this is not. Years ago, I was preaching the Texas camp meeting. And in the camp meeting, the Lord told me to do something unusual. He said, I want you to line up. Instead of having an altar call, and how many of you know, you kind of expected to have an altar call at a camp meeting if you're the evangelist. And they were wanting me to bring the fire and the glory and the house down and all that stuff. And so the Lord spoke to me and said, I don't want you to do that tonight. I want you to call up every widow in this room. And I want you to take up a widow's offering. Now, I'm not good at taking offerings. I'll be honest with you. That's just never been my strength. And so I said, okay. I was afraid not to do it. Everything is bigger in Texas, they say, including the widow's line. I couldn't believe it. I didn't know there were that many widows at the Texas camp meeting. Literally, probably 200 to 300. So there's 200 to 300 women lined up. He didn't tell me to ask for the men for some reason, just the ladies. And they lined up from one end to the other. And I've just finished preaching a sermon, not even about that. And I said, okay, guys, I know some of you have come to receive something from the Lord. And the Lord says that here's how you're going to receive it. You're going to bless these widows. And as you bless them, God's going to take care of you. You're going to take care of their need, and God's going to take care of your need. That's how it's going to work tonight. Okay, but the musicians sang, I didn't know what was going to happen. Honestly, I was shaking in my boots, which you always preach in Texas. But I was shaking in my boots, scared to death that it was just, I didn't know what was going to happen. I saw a miracle happen in front of my eyes. I saw people so excited to get to the altar. People started weeping and crying. I literally saw people climbing over the seats. I saw little ladies up there. They had hands full of money. They were shouting just like this. I mean, they were turning around and shouting. They had money. They were dropping money. People were hugging on them and putting money in their hands. And I just thought it was the most beautiful thing. My daughter, who was working my booth, I said, Brittany, go bless these widows. She grabbed our money bag and gave away everything we had made that week. She just started blessing. She was squalling. Listen, it was worth it just to see my daughter that blessed. She was crying, blessing those little ladies. And she handed out everything we had earned that week. And I walked away from there thinking, okay, God, I don't know what you've done with this miracle, but I know that somebody's life has been blessed and changed. Fast forward 3 years later. No, 4 years later. 4 years after this. Never heard anybody from it. I get a call. I'm pastoring in St. Louis. God's getting ready to call me out of pastoring, and I'm already feeling that pull. And one of the things I said is, Lord, I don't want to leave. I want to leave the church in good shape. I've been pastoring this church for 27 years. We have thousands of people in satellite campuses, but whenever the new pastor comes in, because I chose a 30-year-old to take my place, and the denomination worked with me, and you know all of that, because I wanted to choose my successor. I said, I'm leaving this in the hands of a 30-year-old young man, and I'm setting up another generation. I want him to succeed. I want him to be blessed. And the Lord said, what do you need? I said, I just need a financial miracle. And I didn't put any stipulation on it. So this is a few months before I left Twin Rivers. I get a call from a guy that I'll call Bob. Bob says, Dr. Cutshaw, do you remember 3 or 4 years ago when his old Texas broke? Remember 3 or 4 years ago when you was at that Texas camp meeting and you had those widows to come up there in front and you gave away, everybody gave away their money? He said, my wife and I was trying to earn $500,000 before we retired. He said, we had $250,000 in our retirement fund. The Holy Spirit spoke to her and me and told us to give it all away. I said, are you kidding me? Are you pulling my leg? He said, no. He said, what you don't know, and I had no way, I don't think anybody ever knew it. He said, my wife went down that line writing checks, and she wrote $250,000 worth of checks that night to those widows. No wonder those little ladies were shouting. I get it now. I think some of them would have shouted over a dollar, but this person was writing checks. And I said, well, man, that blesses me so much. Thank you for telling me that. I said, well, what's the rest of the story? He said, well, I lost my job. I thought, oh, man, he's calling to shoot me now. He's from Texas. He's going to shoot me now. I said, you lost your job? He said, yeah, but what you don't know is that I got hired by another company. We started a company. The company went crazy. We sold it. He said, I'm now a multimillionaire. And he said, we were trying to just retire on $500,000. He said, that was the worst thing that ever happened. It was the best thing that ever happened to me in my life. He said, and the Lord reminded me this morning that I've never returned the favor from the guy that unlocked that miracle in my life that night. And I said, well, man, I've never even met you. I'd never heard his name. I'd never met this guy in my life. He said, well, I want to bless your church. And the Lord's told me to put a little check in the mail for you. And I said, well, I appreciate that, brother. He didn't tell me what it was. I get this check. It was handwritten, scribbled on there. God has his name. I get the check in the mail. I open it up. It's not fancy. It's just a regular old short check. It's not even a big one. Just the little short check. I don't know how he got all these zeros on it. Because the check was for $1 million. And I'm standing there, blown away at this. And I went to our business executive. Her name is Trina. I said, Trina, I don't care what you're doing. Stop it right now. Take this to the bank and tell me if it's real. Now, Trina, don't you come back and tell me if it's real. You call me from the bank if it's real. You have the bank check this out to see if this is somebody is just real. Because I've never met this guy. I've never heard his name before. I don't even know who this man is. This could just be play money for all I know. I get a call. I'm sitting there waiting. Okay, Lord, come on, Trina. I see her name on my phone. She called. She said, the bank has verified it. They can't give us the money yet. It's got to be put on hold, but they verified that this is real money from a real bank account, and it's there, and it's our money. And she's crying. I'm shouting. I'm crying. And she comes in the door shouting, and I'm shouting. And I don't care what you think about shouting. If you got $1 million, you'd shout too. I promise you that. I was shouting. I was jumping all up and down. I've been waiting my whole life to tell a story like that. And I thought it just happened to everybody else. Never going to happen to me. Never going to happen to this church. I'm telling you. God says, I want to bless you to be a blessing. And it's not even about you. It's about unlocking a promise. It's about unlocking a treasure. It's about unlocking a future. It's about setting children free and captives free. It's about changing something. It's not even about money. It's not even about, it's about changing something that needs to be changed. And God's just looking for an Abraham. God is just looking for an Abraham that will say, I know it sounds ridiculous, but I'm going to do it. I know it doesn't make sense to me, and it certainly doesn't make financial sense. I'm telling you, I'm not going to take an offering so you can just exhale. You're thinking, I know where this is going. No, you don't, because I'm not even going to take an offering. I'm here to deliver a message, a real message from real people that I know. This is not about something from a foreign country. This is not about, these are people I know. This is Mike and Mary out there blessing a church in Oklahoma this morning in their motorhome, fulfilling a dream. This is about Bob and Mary who were able to write a $1 million check. And I don't know if they've given more than that away to other people. I never ask. I just cashed it. Hallelujah. I love saying that. And I left the church with that $1 million. I didn't even get a dollar of it. I didn't want a dollar of it. It wasn't about me. I wasn't on commission. I got my last paycheck. I handed in my keys and my card, and I'm gone. I'm out of there. I have another pastor. But he's set up the right way. Another generation is free because I had enough faith to say, Lord, if you can use anything, use me. My wife and I are debt-free today. We never thought we would ever be debt-free in our life. We are debt-free today because we did something absolutely crazy. And I promise you, that little principal at that Christian school thought that would never happen to her. Struggling along with 60 students. God has a way of just blowing our minds. If somebody will say, doesn't make sense, but I'm going to step out on faith and do something ridiculous. Trusting that God's going to do something supernatural. You know, maybe people still do walk on water. Maybe they still do walk on water. I know I did. It was troubled water, and I walked over it. Can I tell you that Mike and Mary's kids are both in ministry? And by the way, at the time that we did that, neither one of our daughters were married. My daughter Brittany is married to a youth pastor. My daughter Lindsay is married to a youth pastor. And my daughter Brittany preaches the gospel just like her husband does. And now I have 2 grandbabies and 2 more on the way. I'm a blessed man because I trusted God. Amen. I want you to stand all over the room. I think I've kept you a lot longer than normal. I apologize for that. Here's how I asked Pastor if I could pray this way at the end, and he said I could. So I did this with permission. I want you to take your focus on the future envelope. We're not going to receive an offering. All we're going to do is pray over the envelopes. So can you take one right now? If you don't have one, just raise up your hand. I want you to hold one in your hand because I just want you to ask God one question. That's all I want you to do. This is not a trick. It's not, you know, I'm not fleecing anybody. I don't believe in that. I think that's wrong. So, and I'm not here to earn money. And this is not what this is about. This is about one thing. I don't know who the next Colonel Sanders is, and I don't know who the next Leanne Rimes is, and I don't know who the next Bob and Mary is. I don't know who the next Mike and Mary is. I don't know. I don't know who the next Brian and Faith is. I just know that God's looking for some Abrahams who will say, God, you can trust me to have ridiculous faith if it will set another generation free. I will have ridiculous faith. Because I'll be honest with you, folks, I tipped God for years with that which really didn't cost me much. I never felt it. But when I felt it, it was a game changer. Because God felt it too. It changed everything. So all I want to do is pray over this focus on the future, because I believe. You know, I've been working with you guys now for, you know, Pastor Jason's had me in a couple times. I met with the board and some of the leaders, and I really felt like the Lord birthed this. I was there. I got to be in the room when
when this came out of Pastor's spirit, it was something that rose up out of him. And when I saw this raise up out of his spirit, I knew there was something, a miracle attached to it. I just knew it. And I don't know what kind of lives of kids are going to be changed. I don't know. I don't know how it's going to wreck this city. I don't know how it's going to change this church or how it's going to change your house or your neighborhood or your grandchildren or your family. I don't know. But I'm telling you, there's something big attached to this focus on the future. So all I want you to do is pray over it. I want you to join with me right now and say, Lord, what do you want me to do? Maybe you've already given. Maybe you've already said that. Maybe he didn't give you the. Maybe he didn't tell you to do that. Maybe you just said, oh, I can do that. That's my challenge. Now, I don't want you to do what I want you to do. I'm not even wanting you to do what pastors ask you to do. I want you to ask the Lord one question. Lord, what do you want me to do? I know a girl in our church one time that she was getting married. And she came to me and said, Pastor B, she said, we can't afford a wedding. Can you do it for free? Can we have the church for free? I said, absolutely. Absolutely for free. She had bought a wedding dress, and the Lord told her to give that wedding dress to another girl that needed worship. And she was ready to walk down the aisle in her regular dress. She'd given her wedding dress away. This girl's name's Emily that this happened to. I can give you her address. It's a real story. Emily went to the St. Louis wedding show. Out of all the thousands of people there, put in her name. You know how the story ends. They called her name. She got the biggest wedding St. Louis had ever put on because this little girl in our church gave her wedding dress away. Was it because she gave it away? No. It's because God asked her to give it away, and she did. It wasn't because she gave it away. So you telling me if I give, no, is this gift a gift? No. No, 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 no. You cannot buy God's grace. If you give it just to receive, that's not how it works. But if God says, give it, there's a miracle attached to it, if God says it. So you only have to hear one thing. Lord, what are you saying to me? What are you saying to my house and to me? What are you saying to me and Sarah? That's all you have to hear right now. You're Abraham. So as I pray, I want you to hold this, and I want you to ask the Lord one question. Lord, what is my part in this miracle? Do I need to sow a seed into this miracle that's going to unlock the future?